Lord, we thank you so much for how you gave of yourself and you continue to give and give, for how you empower us to do the same. Lord, help us to offer our lives to you in worship and thanksgiving. Help us to give as you desire for us to give. And not just with money, but with time, with love, compassion, patience, forgiveness. May we reflect your generous heart. Change us. Transform us. May we reflect the glory of Christ with an ever-increasing glory from day to day, week to week, year to year. Help us to be more like you. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Today, we're celebrating the birth of a baby. We celebrate the birth of Jesus and how our lives have been changed because of him. Babies do that, you know. They change lives. The title of this morning's sermon is A Baby Changes Everything. And anyone who's ever had a child or been around children for any length of time knows exactly what I'm talking about. Amen. For example, something as simple as just leaving the house becomes a much more complex endeavor. You can't just jump in the car and go. You've got to make sure the little one is strapped in properly, and you absolutely must not forget the all-important diaper bag. That is your lifeline to survival. In that diaper bag, you need to make sure that you not only have plenty of diapers, but wipes, a change of clothes, a snack of some sort, something to drink, perhaps a few toys. Sometimes just leaving the house can feel like preparing for a small military campaign. And that is just one of a thousand examples that we could give of how a baby changes things. I'm also sure that many parents would attest that having a baby doesn't just change your lifestyle, it changes you. Once that little one arrives, you are simply never quite the same. How ironic that a baby, so small and fragile and helpless, can have such a powerful impact in the lives of others. The birth of Jesus surely changed everything for Mary and Joseph. They would have, of course, had to make the usual changes that come with welcoming a newborn. But they weren't welcoming just any baby. This was Jesus, the Son of God. The birth of Jesus did far more than just change things for Mary and Joseph. That baby in the manger changed the world. Of course, we read in the New Testament of how Jesus changed many lives through what he taught and through the healing of the sick and the raising of the dead. We read of how Jesus changed the lives of his disciples and how after Jesus was resurrected and after he ascended into heaven, his followers gathered together as the church, empowered by the Holy Spirit of God. Those early followers of Christ lived out their faith and talked with others about Jesus. And the church grew. Boy, did it grow. In fact, the church grew at such a pace that within less than 300 years, the followers of Christ went from literally just a few hundred to becoming the predominant religion in the Roman Empire. And this was before any sort of mass media. Books, magazines, radio, television, internet, they had none of those advantages. And yet they grew. As we trace the development of the church and investigate the actions of Christians down through the centuries, we find that through his followers, Jesus changed the world in all sorts of ways. Now, when asked to consider the impact of Christianity, it's not uncommon for many to point to the negative consequences of the advent of Christianity, things such as the Crusades, the Inquisition, the European wars fueled by disagreements between Christians over dogma, things like that. Has Christianity done good for the world or bad for the world? And they'll point to those sorts of things. But they're pointing to people who claimed to be Christians and yet did very un-Christ-like things in the name of Christ. The things I just listed, that's not what Christ brought. That's not what his early followers taught. So we need to be fair. And I think if we are fair, and if one takes the time to dig into history instead of just reading the surface sound bites, to actually read what happened over history, one will find that the true impact and legacy of Christianity has been overwhelmingly positive. For example, as they sought to follow the example and teachings of Christ, Christians went into the world to serve others, and they founded churches, hospitals, schools, charities, orphanages, homeless shelters. The list goes on and on. All of these different ways of communicating the love of Jesus to the world. It was the transforming power of the gospel of Jesus Christ that tamed the brutal, rampaging pagan tribes of medieval Europe. If you've read anything about history, have you ever heard of the Vikings? We're not talking about a football team. And a sack was something that happened to more than just a quarterback. The Vikings, they did some terrible things. Well, why don't we have Vikings anymore? Why don't we still have hordes rampaging through Europe and showing up in a port and just taking whatever they want? It was Christianity that tamed the Vikings. And they weren't the only European tribe that was, I guess you could say, civilized through the message of Jesus. The abolition of slavery in both Europe and America was spearheaded by Christians. Many historians argue that it was Christianity that provided the necessary context for the development of both modern science and the idea that every person has basic human rights that should be respected. We take such things like that for granted. But there are many historians, and not just Christian historians, who argue that it was Christianity that provided the context for those things to blossom. The existence of public education for all, something else that we take for granted in our country, public education for all, that is largely the product of Christianity. Did you know that? Throughout most of history, only the wealthy and socially advantaged were educated. But with the rise of Protestant Christianity in the 1500s came the conviction that everyone should be taught to read and write so that they could read the Bible. That's why they started working so hard to educate everyone so they could read the Bible. In England in 1780, a man named Robert Raikes began a new movement called Sunday School. You ever heard of it? It was originally intended to be a means by which poor children could be taught to read and write and receive instruction in Christianity. The Sunday school movement was the forerunner to the current English school system. The beginnings of public education in America can be traced to Puritan colonists who required every town in their colonies to have a school so that children could be taught to read and write so they could read the Bible for themselves. Most of the great universities were founded for the primary purpose of educating people in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oxford, Cambridge, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, William and Mary, Dartmouth, Columbia University, Northwestern University, the list goes on and on, all had Christian origins. As a matter of fact, I found one source that said of the first 123 colleges and universities established in America, all had Christian origins. That's how they started. Harvard began as a school to train ministers. My, how times have changed. Dartmouth began as a school to train Native Americans to be Christian missionaries to their own people. Even Berea College began for the purpose of promoting the cause of Christ and was founded on explicitly Christian convictions. Now, we could go on and on talking about the positive impact that Christianity has had in all sorts of areas, including music, art, economics, science, government, social activism. Indeed, entire books have been written on the subject of the impact of Christianity, not just in Western civilization, but in cultures throughout the world. There are many cultures in the world that have a written language today only because Christian missionaries went there and developed a written language so that they could present them the Scripture, the Word of God, in their language. I remember something I came across when I was preparing for the sermon this week. Thought this was kind of interesting. It was talking about how, of course, you know, for many years we had the Soviet Union, a declared atheist state. And part of the irony of that, of course, Russia has a rich Christian heritage and tradition and history. Part of the irony of this Soviet state was that their language, Russian, the alphabet, the Cyrillic alphabet on which that's based, the Slavic languages, where that comes from, that was developed by Christian missionaries in order to communicate the gospel to people in that part of the world. So the very alphabet they were using whenever they would write their atheistic communist slogans was in an alphabet that was part of the heritage of Christianity. Interesting. We could go on and on about this, and it would be a lot of fun to do so, but we're not. Don't have time. I know that we've got families to get back to and all sorts of good things to eat and presents to open and things like that, and I certainly would not want to rain on any of that. But what I'm trying to communicate is that it's difficult to imagine what our lives would be like today if Jesus had never lived. The course of human history was forever changed by that baby in Bethlehem. A baby changes everything. That baby really changed everything. Back in the 1920s, Dr. James Allen Francis put it quite well in his famous description of Jesus entitled One Solitary Life. Perhaps you've read it. He wrote, "He was born in an obscure village, the child of a peasant woman. He grew up in still another village where he worked in a carpenter shop until he was 30. Then for 3 years, he was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never had a family or owned a house. He didn't go to college. He never visited a big city. He never traveled 200 miles from the place where he was born. He did none of the things one usually associates with greatness. He had no credentials but himself. He was only 33 when the tide of public opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. He was turned over to his enemies and went through the mockery of a trial. He was nailed to a cross between two thieves. While he was dying, his executioners gambled for his clothing, the only property he had on earth. When he was dead, he was laid in a borrowed grave through the pity of a friend. 19 centuries have come and gone, and today he is the central figure of the human race. All the armies that ever marched, all the navies that ever sailed, all the parliaments that ever sat, all the kings that ever reigned put together have not affected the life of man on this earth as much as that one solitary life. A baby changes everything. The birth of baby Jesus did just that. Changed everything. But of all the changes brought by his coming, the greatest is that through him we may be forgiven of our sins and reconciled to God. We can be saved. Jesus died for our sins and then rose from the dead and thereby opened a way for us to have an eternal relationship with God. Famous passage, John chapter 3, beginning in verse 16, we read these words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." The birth of Jesus changed the world. But did the birth of Jesus change you? That's very much another question. Has Jesus changed your life? How has Jesus changed your life? As followers of Jesus, we claim that Jesus is Lord, the one upon whom we base our lives, the one whose voice we most try to follow when we make important decisions. But is that true? Can we truly say that the way we live is shaped and defined by our relationship with Jesus? If Jesus were to suddenly not be part of your life at all, would your lifestyle change in any significant way? Think about it. Think through your week. Think through your month. If Jesus were to not be part of your life at all, would your lifestyle change in any significant way? If our answer to that question is no, then something isn't right. You cannot experience the salvation of God and become a follower of Jesus and not be changed. It's part of it. Have you truly, wholeheartedly invited Jesus to come and live inside you and change your life? This baby changes everything. Has he changed you? During this time of invitation, if you need to come and talk and pray, I'll be right at the front. Associate Pastor Russell Cole will also be waiting for you. But let's think about that, guys. Christmas. Christmas. What a joyful time. As the song says, the most wonderful time of the year. It is only wonderful because of Jesus, because of who he is and what it means and how the world has been changed and how you and I can be changed through Jesus. Would you stand? Please.